Greenhouse warming theory is rapidly becoming the most expensive mistake ever made in the history of science. Video 14. What actions should we take now to reduce global warming? We need to improve enforcement of the Montreal Protocol on substances that deplete the ozone layer, especially for chlorofluorocarbon gases known as CFCs. CFCs became very popular in the 1960s because they were cheaper, more effective, and safer to use than alternatives for spray can propellants, refrigerants, solvents, and foam blowing agents. CFCs are very stable gases that do not interact with most other gases or materials until they are broken down in the stratosphere by very energetic solar ultraviolet radiation, releasing atoms of chlorine. What makes CFCs so damaging for climate is that only one atom of chlorine under very cold conditions in the stratosphere, typical in winter months, can lead to the destruction of more than 100,000 molecules of ozone. Thus, a very small amount of CFCs can cause significant depletion of the ozone layer, the Achilles heel of climate change. The ozone layer normally absorbs most ultraviolet B radiation from sun, protecting life on Earth from this very hot radiation. When ultraviolet B radiation reaches Earth, it causes global warming, crop damage, and increased risk of sunburn, cataracts, depression of the immune system, and genetic damage that can lead to skin cancer and mutations. Major increases in the production of CFCs in the 1970s and 1980s led to depletion of the ozone layer and global warming of about 0.6 degrees Celsius. As long as CFC production was increasing, ozone depletion and average global temperatures were increasing. When CFC production was severely curtailed as a result of the Montreal Protocol, ozone depletion and global temperatures stopped increasing, but both have remained high. Ultraviolet B penetrates oceans hundreds of feet and thus continues to increase ocean heat content very efficiently. Ultraviolet B sunburns plankton and coral reefs. Ultraviolet B also sublimes snow and melts glaciers. As a result, sea level continues to rise. The other problem with CFCs is that they last in the atmosphere for many decades. Since 2000, stratospheric ozone has been recovering at a very slow rate of 1-3% per decade. The Antarctic ozone hole is recovering very slowly. Total column ozone over Antarctica is not anticipated to return to 1980 levels for at least another 40 years. However, this recovery could be delayed. The longer it takes for the ozone layer to recover, the hotter the oceans will become, which means the hotter Earth will become. But the rate of warming of the ocean is very slow compared to rates predicted for greenhouse warming of air because of the huge heat content of oceans. The Montreal Protocol is one of the greatest success stories of international environmental diplomacy, stopping the increase in ozone depletion and global temperatures within a decade after it took effect in 1989. While there were alternative gases that did not deplete ozone, converting existing air conditioners, refrigerators, and freezers to use these gases cost hundreds of dollars for each home-sized unit and for each automobile. A major feature of the Montreal Protocol was to phase out CFCs faster in developed countries. This led to a thriving black market for CFCs, legally manufactured in developing countries, but illegally diverted to developed countries for maintenance of existing equipment. By the mid-1990s, CFCs were the second largest illegal import via Miami, second only to cocaine. Illicit trade in ozone-depleting substances has been a significant problem, slowing recovery of the ozone layer. Continued vigilance is required. In 2010, production of CFCs became illegal in China. In 2018, however, scientists measured atmospheric concentrations of CFC-11 in eastern China that suggested a major increase since 2012. The Environmental Investigation Agency traced the source to at least 18 factories producing polyol blend rigid foam used widely for insulation of buildings. The manufacturers admitted that they knew CFC was illegal, but it was cost-effective and it was utilized by all their competitors. After this illegal manufacturing attracted international attention, the Chinese government has improved enforcement of the Montreal Protocol. Shorter-lived ozone-depleting substances such as chloroform and dichloromethane have not been included in the Montreal Protocol because their effects did not appear to be that important. But production levels have now increased such that they are delaying recovery of the ozone layer for at least a few years. There is considerable research needed to fully understand the precise chemical path and how chlorine and bromine atoms are carried up into the stratosphere, both from man-made sources and especially from effusive basaltic volcanic sources. There is still much to learn about the details of ozone depletion and of atmospheric mixing at different latitudes and different seasons of the year. Can we discover ways to speed recovery of the ozone layer? When ozone is depleted, more solar ultraviolet B radiation reaches Earth, where it dissociates ground-level ozone pollution, warming air in highly populated and industrialized regions. As the ozone layer recovers, less ultraviolet B radiation will reach Earth, destroying less ground-level ozone. This very toxic ground-level ozone pollution could become a greater problem. The greatest problem for humanity, though, from burning fossil fuels, is air pollution. Currently, at least 4.8 million premature deaths occur every year as a result of exposure to air pollution. Pollution is greatest in China, India, much of Southeast Asia, and Africa. Currently, 91% of the world's population lives in places where air quality exceeds limits recommended by the World Health Organization. Ground-level ozone pollution is currently destroying 21% of India's wheat crop and 6% of its rice. Since the 1970s, we have reduced ground-level ozone and other pollution in the United States, but many cities are not currently meeting EPA guidelines. This newspaper story in the Los Angeles Times on July 1, 2019, documents how air quality in Los Angeles is slipping once again. We have the technology to reduce these losses substantially, and the cost is far less than trying to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. Thank you.